Hello everyone, welcome to ASR's IAS Institute. Today we have with us All India Rank 93 in UPSC 2019, Ms. Aishwarya Sharon. She needs no introduction now. She has been all over on all platforms, on social media, in media across the nation. So congratulations, Aishwarya. It's very nice to have you with us. So I'll give
Thank
a little
so
introduction.
Much,
yes, I'll give a little introduction about Aishwarya before we begin. You have seen many interviews of her right now on various news channels, but what was missing was actual UPSC preparation. How did she go ahead and prepare for civil services? So that is the basic idea. In this video, we are going to give you all the details about how she prepared, apart from all the other things which have been highlighted. So that is very, very important, because you should know she cleared her first in her first attempt with All India Rank 93. And that's a big achievement in itself, keeping everything else apart. So let's begin. You should know she belongs from Rajasthan. She did her schooling from Delhi. She graduated from Shriram College of Commerce in 2017. And since 2018, she has been preparing for civil services. And in 1 year's preparation, she has cleared all three stages, prelims, mains, and interview. So it's very important to know this journey and how she went ahead with it, and how she did her self-study, how she prepared for it, whether she took notes, whether she referred to any other material, what are the important sources she referred to. So we'll be seeing all of it in detail in this video. So let's begin. Hi, Aishwarya. So first of all, I would like to ask you, when you started preparing for civil services, was it like sure that you wanted to go for civil services with your first attempt on your self-preparation, or like how did you start off it? Did you have any hesitation in the beginning about how do you go about it as a beginner?
Ma'am, definitely. I think when you start taking the first step, that is the time when you feel the most anxious. Right. But as soon as you start preparing, when you get into that zone of preparation, I think slowly all those fears, they start fading away. So when I picked up my books, when I actually looked up to UPSC syllabus, definitely I was nervous, I was anxious, I was worried as to, you know, how am I going to complete it? And mentally I had this target of doing it in 1 year.
Right.
But for me, it was never a do or die thing. I always believe that, you know, you should give yourself second chance. But at the same time, I had this mental target that, you know, if I clear it in my first attempt, it would be, you know, it would be great. So that was the goal with which I started my preparation.
Right. So what were the initial, in the initial period, how did you take guidance? How did you know what books to refer? What was your first initial step in this preparation?
A lot of media has been saying a lot of things about my preparation. Some say that, you know, it was a 10-month preparation. Some say it was a 1 year. Some say 2 years. But I think through this video, I would like to clarify that I started my preparation in May 2018. I gave my prelims in May 2019. So 1 year exactly before my exam, I started preparing.
Right.
So that was first. Now, ma'am, coming to how I went about it. So, ma'am, initial 15 days, May 1st to May 15th, all I did was to understand the syllabus. I got the syllabus printed out. I stuck it in front of me just to get an idea that, you know, what all subjects are covered in GS1, what is there in GS2, GS3, GS4, and so on. I decided on my optional at that point of time. And I also understood myself. So for 1 day, I did this test of, you know, actually getting to know that how much can I actually study in 1 day. So I picked up old NCERT books of my brother, and I just started randomly reading them just to get an idea of my present capacity.
Right.
So at that point of time, I could study for about nine and a half hours. So I figured out that, okay, approximately 10 hours is the thing which I can do comfortably without getting exhausted, because it's a very long exam. And if you burn your fuel right in the beginning, then chances are that you're sooner or later going to give up. So it's better to follow a balanced approach.
Right. You say 10 hours of preparation a day, that is ideal. Like, you cannot go beyond that without, as you rightly pointed out, you cannot go beyond that. We keeping the consistency. If you go beyond that, you can't keep the consistency. And this is 1 year's preparation, right? So exactly correctly is pointed out. Then about your preparation for prelims. So what books did you refer? Because this is generally a question which every beginner asks. And every topper also gives the same list of books, but it has to be reiterated. So I'm again asking you this question. What books did you refer for prelims for every subject?
Ma'am, I am going to release a detailed book list, but yes. A thumb rule that I followed was that one topic, one book.
Correct.
Now, it doesn't mean that suppose if I'm talking about history, I only read Spectrum for history. I read Bipin Chandra, post-independence, pre-independence, both. But I read them only once and kept them aside. So they were only my read-only-once books. And my ultimate revision book, the core study material, was Spectrum only. So I kept my sources so limited that I could revise them again and again. And since my books were so limited, the core books that I used to revise every day, so I did not feel the need to make separate notes for them. I only made notes for my optionals. And for GS, I kept my books so limited that I could write them through the book itself. So that was the plan I followed. For prelims specifically, ma'am, throughout the year, I followed a prelim cum main strategy. I did not divide or segregate or compartmentalize my syllabus. But definitely 1 month before the prelim, I started attempting a lot of mock tests. So a lot of mock tests are available freely online. So I downloaded them and I did about 25 to 30 mock tests. I used to do the mock test in the morning in 1.5 hours because you can never underestimate, you know, what can happen in the exam hall. So you should keep that buffer time with you. So I practiced for the worst 1.5 hours so that, you know, even if worse happen, I still have 1/2 hour to go in the exam hall. That is how I prepared. And in the evening, I used to revise the answers of the test that I gave in the morning. So that was through that I got to know the pattern of the syllabus, pattern for the prelims, what kind of questions are actually being asked from geography, from culture, from history. So I think it's very important to practice mock papers.
Okay. So when did you begin? Just a month before prelims, or were you practicing mock papers before that?
Ma'am, for prelims, I began just a month before. Before that, it was prelims come main strategy for me because I had very limited time.
Okay. So then about answer writing, were you practicing answer writing for mains when you were doing your preparation?
Ma'am, I started answer writing in January 2019.
Okay, before your
prelims. Because first, yes, ma'am, because I thought that, you know, first I should at least know what is there to write because when I started, I was a blank slate. My subjects were economics in my college, and in my 11th class I had science. So subjects like tree, polity, they were pretty new to me in that sense because I left them in my 10th grade. So I think I gathered that material, gathered my notes, and then I started answer writing in January.
Right, because initially you can't start answer writing because you don't have the content with you. So how would you write answers? That's exactly correctly pointed out. Then about your book list, I just want the core books from you presently. So you said history, Spectrum, for polity, the core.
So, ma'am, if I talk about subject wise, so for say GS1, modern history was covered by Spectrum. Yeah. World history covered by Vision IS Notes. They have they have two sets, set one and set two. So both of them, I got them downloaded and printed them. Thirdly, ma'am, if you talk about ancient and medieval history, then there are very thin books of called Tamil Nadu books.
Okay.
So they're very thin books and you can finish them off in 1 or 2 days, and I used to revise them again. So ancient and medieval, I did not spend much time on it because I saw the pattern, the questions are not very, it's not a high-weighted subject anymore.
Right.
So I really had to prioritize.
Right.
Ma'am, talking about geography, now 11th, it was. Apart from that, world geography was covered by G.C. Leong book.
Okay.
I'm sure everybody is aware of it. It's again a very thin book. So I
NCRT,
the size of the book and then decide. Yes, right. So geography, it was NCRT.
NCRTs, right. Okay.
I and did quality? Read Majid Hussain once, but then I read it once. And I kept it aside because I thought that it's a very bulky book and there's no way I can revise through that book. So I read it, whatever explanation I found in it, I wrote it in my NCRTs itself, and then I moved on.
So you used to make points in your NCERTs in your one book itself, so that any extra point is also there in that same book. Very good.
So ma'am, I read a lot of material, but I kept on shedding that material, and whatever was to be noted, I noted in my basic core books itself, so that I can revise it again and again. Ma'am, for art and culture, I followed the Nitin Singhania book. I think it pretty much covers every topic which is to be there. Apart from that, ma'am, if you talk about society, then society was one topic which is a very general topic.
Right.
So I mostly practice it from the mock tests and along with my essay and ethics preparation. Because these topics are related. You know, in essay also, in ethics also, you have these issues coming up. So I piled them all and I made my own notes. And it was a one set of notes for me. So these three topics, I kept them aside to be done after prelims.
Right.
So that is how I segregated. For GS2, Lakshmikant it was for me, the Bible of Polity.
Right.
So Lakshmikant. Apart from that, I downloaded an entire list of all the government schemes. So you can download it from any website, Insight or Vision IAS. All of them have beautifully compiled the government schemes in one particular document. You can download it, get it printed. And I used to revise it every day. So one ministry, I used to revise every day. So suppose it's Renewable Energy Ministry. So I would do all the schemes of that ministry in one day, and then the other day, some other ministry. And that kept going on throughout my preparation. So by the end of my prelims, I was pretty much, it was all in my head finally. It took some time, but I could actually figure out which ministry is responsible for which scheme.
Right.
So that is how I did my government schemes and the implementation part of Polity. Apart from that, ma'am, for international relations, I did not study any book. I did the Vision IAS notes again. Okay. And other than that, I went on the Ministry of External Affairs website. It's very rare for a government ministry to have such a beautiful website, I must say. And they have a proper bilateral relations kept separately. So I, for each and every country, which was important for India, I made a separate page for their bilateral relations and compiled my own notes.
Okay.
So I got the information there. So those were purely my notes. And so that's how the international relation, apart from the current affairs, of course, because Polity is all about current affairs. For GS3, again, ma'am, economics, because my optional was economics. So that was covered along with the optional. But for other subjects like disaster management, environment, I refer to the Vision IAS notes. Science and technology, I read books of class NCERT, current affairs. That's it. So science and technology, when you attempt the papers, when you see the papers and the mains paper, you'll realize that there is very little static portion. Nowadays, the pattern is all about dynamic and, you know, the current information that is. So that is why I felt that it's better to focus more on current affairs, especially in a topic like science and technology. And similarly for security also, ma'am, again, Vision IAS notes it was for me. So a lot of my preparation, especially for GS3, was based on dynamic topics and current affairs. Now GS4, ethics, I must say it was my father who really opened my eyes, because he told me, you know, that ethics is one paper which can really change your rank. So you must focus on ethics. And it was only our prelims that I started giving essay and ethics this time. So I used to collect stories from my own life. I made my own notes for ethics. Apart from that, ma'am, I had a proper audio recorded in my own voice of all the good quotations that I could find on different topics. So for education, for health, I had a series of quotations which I had recorded in my own voice. And I used to play it whenever I used to go for walks or, you know, work out, do anything. So you can play it in your free time. And by the time the exam comes, you actually have all of them remembered. So I think I found these innovative ways to do ethics and essay and the society topic, so that at least I don't feel the burden of an extra subject. These can be done simultaneously with other subjects, and they are much lighter, but you should definitely pay attention to them.
Right. Wow. We've covered precisely every paper of GS mains with every topic being covered. So syllabus is very well in your head, is clearly evident. So yes, that's how the preparation should be too. Another thing for current affairs, basically, how did you go ahead with current affairs?
Ma'am, for current affairs, I think I did a lot of hit and trial. Initially, when I was making my notes, like everybody else, I was spending hours and hours on the newspaper. And I was wasting a lot of time. About 2 to 3 hours used to get wasted in reading The Hindu and one more newspaper, The Indian Express. But then I thought that, you know, I cannot devote so much time just making the notes, because you also need the time to revise those notes. And if they are too bulky, then they don't solve the purpose at all.
Right.
So then I changed my strategy, ma'am. By the end of June, I realized all of this. And then I started the other way around. I used to go on website called Insights Current Affairs. I used to make my notes first from there. Okay. Then I used to open the Indian Express app. Okay. The editorials, I used to specifically read the editorials. If I found a punchline there, I used to write it for my essay papers. So for essay, I had a separate notebook in which I used to write these good punchlines which were there in the editorials if I found something very interesting. And then finally, I used to open my newspaper and see what extra am I left with. So then my entire note making became very concise. I could finish it off in 40 minutes and save the rest of the time for my revision. So I used to revise those notes on the same day. Then again after 24 hours, and then again on Saturday. Saturday was only meant for my current affairs revision. So I think revision strategy is very important in this exam, especially for current affairs. Otherwise, you'll go on making notes and it will go all above your head, and you won't remember anything when the exam comes.
The notes have to be concise so that you can keep revising them again and again, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Correct. Exactly. And about this is about your current affairs preparation, and you wrote your mains answers when you started writing. Were you getting them evaluated? Were you getting any feedback? How was it?
Ma'am, I had joined the Vision IAS test series. There were a series of 21 mock tests. I used to send them online, scan my papers, send them online, get the feedback, again get them printed, see what I've done.
Okay.
So, ma'am, I think giving the mock test was the best decision of my life, because then you realize the mistakes that you're making.
Right.
Because when you're preparing, it's very easy to get ignorant about it, that you know answer to likhi lenge. But that is not how it is. When I gave my first paper, it took me 4 hours, 10 minutes. I still remember. I took 4 hours and 10 minutes to finish that paper.
Right.
And by the end of it, I was actually crying, because I thought that, you know, I've studied so much and I wouldn't be able to produce it on the paper. So it's of no use, because the examiner does not know what's there in your head. He or she only knows what's there in front of him. So I thought this is not going to work for me. So then again, I worked on my answer writing strategy. I tried to reduce the sentences, the words that I write. So for example, ma'am, if I have to write center and state governments should work together on this particular scheme, instead of that, if you just write cooperative federalism way forward,
reduces your number
of words. Yes, ma'am. Apart from that, ma'am, I realized that point making, you know, writing your answers in points is what works for me, because I was a science student. I do not like writing stories. I am a straightforward the point girl. So I think that reflected in my answers. So I wrote all my answers in points. Right. And the general format of introduction, body, conclusion was followed. But my introduction was only a one-liner. And similarly, my conclusion was at the max 1 or 2 lines. And that also was separate from the rest of the content that I used to write in the body. So if you genuinely have an extra point, then please write the conclusion. But if you're just writing a vague sentence, it's not going to get you marks.
Right.
So your conclusion has to be a way forward, or you know, something optimistic, or you, if you can think of a fact or a policy, do write that. But if you're just writing a sentence which has no meaning, I don't think it's going to get you marks. Instead, it may waste your time. So you better move on. And apart from that, ma'am, for different subjects, I figured out that I have to write the answers differently. So for my ethics, I did make little paragraphs. It looks nicer and it gives you a sense of continuity.
Right.
For science and technology questions, it's all about the facts. So it's better if you write in points and be very precise about them, because they are only going to see the limited information that they're looking for. So there's no point like writing any flowery language over there. It's better to, you know, not make any more decorations and just let it be. If you know something, write it. Otherwise, move on. Focus on the answers that you can write better. Similarly, for security questions, I made a lot of diagrams. I made the India map. And then I used to show different security issues that were there in different parts of India. So that part was covered. So that saved my time. So similarly, ma'am, for different topics, I used a different approach. And finally, I was able to finish my papers on time.
Wow. So it requires a lot of practice to actually finish off the paper in 3 hours too. And that you put in all those efforts for that. Wow.
But ma'am, I think if you put mock tests, then only you can improve, you know, step by step. So it's not about getting conscious about the marks you're getting in your mock test, but do take the feedback very seriously. Focus on your strengths. I think that is the message I would like to give.
Right. Because you cannot study in silos too. You need feedback. You need response. You need to know how are you preparing? Where are you going ahead? Yes. Where are you lacking, so that you can improve and make your preparation up to the mark. Very nice. And about the interview, like you gave a mock interview with us. Can you discuss a little about that too? And we would like to know about your full interview too, the actual UPSC interview.
So ma'am, initially, like all the other candidates, I was anxious that, you know, interview is coming and maybe I should, you know, go for a lot of mock interviews. So I found the institute which was firstly nearest to my house. That was your institute. I thought maybe I should go there once and then, you know, maybe other institutes. When I came to your institute, ma'am, I gave my first mock test, first and my only mock test, because the feedback that you gave me, I think, ma'am, it really stayed in my head, because you told me to stay original, not look rehearsed. And I think it's beautiful, ma'am, the kind of honest feedback that I got from you. I don't think people usually do that, because, you know, any coaching institute would like to take multiple mock tests and, you know,
You wanted to give one more with us too, but I insisted you don't need that.
Yes, ma'am.
Right.
So I think it's impeccable on your side. But ma'am, if we talk about my interview, how it went actually, I went for the interview alone. I did not take my parents along with me, because I thought, you know, it will be an extra pressure on me, because they'll be waiting outside to, you know, get the feedback and how it went, what it went. So I thought it's better to just go alone, do it smooth and safer. I think it's smoother and safer that way. So I went to UPSC half an hour before I reached there, waited, then the gates opened. I was very anxious. There were other candidates as well. So, and their parents. So I was missing my family. I went inside. Then there's a big hall in which you're supposed to wait. There were about 6 people in my group. And I was the second to go.
Okay.
So when you go there, ma'am, they take you at least 10 to 15 minutes before the other candidate comes out of the chamber.
Right.
And you have to wait outside, sit on this, I would like to call it a hot seat, waiting for your turn to come. And there is a red bulb right in front of the chamber. And so it gives you that ICU kind of feeling. So at that point of time, I was naturally very nervous. I was turning red. But then when you go inside, ma'am, the panel, they really make you comfortable. Very, I think they do their job wonderfully. So irrespective of where you come from, what your background is, what is there in your DAF, whether you have been in service or not, they have this, I would say, energy to make everything look positive and at ease. So I think, ma'am, Then I was happy when
Which
I came out
did
after
you get?
About. Ma'am, my panel was B.B. Vyas, sir.
Okay.
He was the chairman of my panel.
Right.
So, so, ma'am, that's how it went for about 30 minutes, 28 to 30 minutes. I don't remember the exact time. Was how long it was.
We would like to know a few questions which were asked.
Definitely, ma'am.
Yeah, sure.
So, ma'am, when I entered, there were about 5 members inside the chamber. The chairman started with my economics background. So he read out my detailed application form and he said, okay, you're from SRCC. So on that very day, ma'am, Donald Trump was visiting India.
Right.
So naturally, the question of US-India trade deal came. And he said, you know, if you have to represent India and you have to make the trade deal, what would you say? How would you convince them to be in our favor, the terms to be in our favor? So I think, ma'am, most of the questions then carried on these lines. US-India trade relations, India-China, all these economic topics. Then, ma'am, I was asked about Khap Panchayat because my birth state is Haryana. So I was asked about the institution of Khap Panchayat. I was also asked about infrastructure. National infrastructure pipeline was launched not very long ago. So they asked me questions about it. You know, what field of infrastructure would you like to focus on? And I said, you know, being in the government, my focus would be on social infrastructure. So public health, education, that would be my first priority. And apart from that, ma'am, the questions were mostly on my economics background. So there were also questions on the education policy. That time it was still a draft. So they asked me questions that, you know, if you are the HRD minister, what kind of education policy would you like to frame? So I think, ma'am, it was, I was happy when I came out of the interview hall. I think I answered most of the questions, apart from one tricky question, which was, there was a lady panel member, and she was wearing a beautiful sari. And the other panel member asked me that, you know, Ishwara, can you tell us which sari it is that ma'am is wearing? And ma'am, obviously, I couldn't figure out from that distance. And also, it's very difficult to identify handloom made materials that easily. So, but I think, ma'am, what they were checking was how calm and confident I am, even if I don't know the answer. So to all the aspirants who are watching me right now, I would like to say, it's not about your knowledge. It's a personality test. So please be honest, please be original. That is what they're looking for. You know, if you really have that officer-like quality in you, that is what their ultimate aim is. Right. So do not get nervous. If you reach that stage, please don't spoil it by being all rehearsed and giving, you know, flowery answers. Be original, be honest, speak from your heart, and I think they would recognize your potential.
Right. That's a wonderful advice. And one more thing which you would like to know is about the optional, like economics optional. There would be some students from economics optional background who would like to know how did you go ahead with that preparation too. Like some standard books you can list down, some 4 to 5, and some general strategy about your optional.
So ma'am, optional preparation, I started in August 2018. So August, September, October, those were my 3 months specifically meant for optional. I used to only revise my GS syllabus for about an hour or so during these months. Because initially I did my GS, and then for these 3 months I focused solely on my optional. So I made detailed notes from books like for international economics I followed Salvatore. For macroeconomics it was Froyen. For microeconomics it was Ahuja. For public economics, it was Bhatia. Ma'am, all these are economists' name, and I'm sure people who have this background, they would recognize the name. So I'm anyway going to come out with a detailed book list. But these were the books, and a standard practice was that if there are 20 pages in the book, I used to compile it in about half a page. So my notes were so precise, because in the exam, you don't get to write in more than 150 to 200 words. There is no point making elaborate notes which you can't produce on the paper. Only make notes which you can actually write in the exam. and revise them multiple times so that, you know, they sort of get printed in your head. So you don't actually have to think about, you know, what to write when the question comes. So okay. That was my plan, ma'am. Very concise notes. I could revise them in one day before my actual mains paper. And I think that really helped me. So I think if you make notes for the option, it's always a good idea. For GS, you can still skip the note making process. Right. But for optional, it becomes very important.
Okay. So lastly, now we have a few questions. Those which we have not covered, we'll just go through them. There have been questions. We had asked students to put forth their questions to us, which we can ask you. So I'll just see which questions we have not covered. So we'll answer them. Like, there are questions like, what should be the strategy for working professionals? Study material resources we have covered. Current affairs, how many years current affairs should you read? So first of all, working professional. Like, these are three questions from one student, Umaira Mansuri.
So ma'am, I think ma'am, it'll be better if we go one by one.
Yeah.
So for working professionals, ma'am, I wasn't working. I was studying full time. I know it's a very difficult job to balance both. But I think, ma'am, if you plan it out in a way that you spend more time on your weekend studying, and for the rest of the day, you can rest of the week, you should focus on current affairs probably, because that keeps on increasing. Your static portion is static. You can always study it on weekend. But your current affairs, they keep on increasing. Every day, new syllabus is coming in.
Right.
So it's better to make notes of them every day and revise them on the same day itself, so that somewhere it stays in your head. You can revise them multiple times when you're traveling, when you're, you know, free, during your job. So I think on the weekdays, if they can focus on current affairs, and on the weekends, maybe on the static portion, I think that would be helpful for them.
Right.
Ma'am, your second current question
affairs.
Was?
Current affairs, how many years current affairs should we read is the question.
Ma'am, current affairs, as the name suggests, it should be current. So I would suggest 1 year before the exam would be fine.
Exactly.
There's a lot of flexibility in what the UPSC can ask. But again, ma'am, you cannot know everything under the sun, and you should not know everything under the sun.
Right.
So prepare only as per your capacity. I prepared for 1 year current affairs, and I think it was enough for me. So I think that is the way to go. 1 month before the prelims, you can stop making current affairs notes. Similarly, 1 month before the mains, you can stop making current affairs notes. But apart from that, the entire year, basically.
Yeah. Basically, we also prepare current affairs. I teach current affairs. We do daily current affairs. And even if you look at 2019 prelims paper, there were questions in current affairs which came from 2 years back.
Yes,
there were questions. But then the idea is that even if there are such questions, you can't change your strategy, because you can't go 2 years and 3 years back and start preparing. So those are the kind of questions which is okay if you don't remember, or if you just skip them.
Ma'am, so I don't think there's anyone who can, you know, do all the 100 questions in prelims.
Right.
There will always be some questions you don't know, but you should be smart enough to know what to study and what to skip.
What not to study. Correct.
Yes,
exactly. Ma'am. Exactly. Then there is one more question. Ashutosh Pandey also asked the same question, how to prepare as a working professional, which majorly in Mumbai, we have many students who are working as well as preparing. Okay, then books, magazine, we have covered. Answer writing, we have covered. Current affairs, essay tips also, you gave a wonderful tip of making notes. So these were questions from Devang, we have covered.
Ma'am, to cut you short for essay.
Yeah.
I would like to say that after my prelims, I did not get exactly the time to write full essays, because you have your optionals and then you have your mock test going on. But what I did was to make a skeleton sketch of, you know, one topic each every day. So, for example, if I'm writing on a particular topic, I may not write the entire essay, but I will definitely in my notebook write the basic rough sketch of what I would have written had I written the entire essay. So my introduction would be this. After that, I would write this. After that, this. So that thinking stays with you when you go for the exam. Yes,
you did the brainstorming for every topic. Right.
Yes, ma'am. I used to discuss it with my father. So I think it's very important to widen your perspective. You need not write the entire essay, because essay paper, time is not an issue. You have to write two essays and you can easily finish it. What's more important is to have an overall analyzing ability. to write that essay from different points of views. And for that, if you practice every day, it would be really helpful.
Wow. You need diverse points and you get with brainstorming, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Good. There's one question from Mr. Nitish Kumar. He asks, I'm a UPSC aspirant and I want to know the best routine and timetable for civil services. So what was your timetable like?
Ma'am, it all depends on the kind of person you are. You know, everybody has their different way of studying. It's not a one-size-fits-all approach.
Right.
So, you know, it's all over the news. I used to study for 10 hours and 8 hours sleep and 6 hours or whatever I like. But even in that 10 hours, ma'am, 2 hours was specifically for current affairs, which included note-making and revising.
Okay.
Then again, I used to do heavy topics in the morning because I'm an early riser. So 5:30 to say 8:30, I used to revise the heaviest topic for the day, say history or polity, whichever you find difficult, or it may be your optional subject. And as the day goes forward, as you feel tired, because, you know, naturally everybody is a human being and they get tired and you can't study throughout the day. So for me, it was the night, which was the most difficult time to study. So say after my dinner, I used to study for about 2 hours and that is the time. So, you know, I get my phone and with that point of time. Because it's something that you have to do anyway. You can't skip it. You can't say that, okay, I'm going to make the notes tomorrow. So that was a discipline that kept me going at my weakest time of the day. So no matter how tired I was, I anyway had to finish my current affairs. Otherwise, it was all going to pile up the next day. So that is how I planned. And it's a very individual decision, ma'am.
We just missed you. Your voice broke. Last 2 hours of the day, you said, what were you doing in the last 2 hours? After dinner?
From the last 2 hours, I used to devote for newspaper note making
current
and revising.
Great.
Yes, ma'am.
Exactly. This is what we also suggest, because start of the day, you are fresh, you can cover heavy topics. I generally suggest that you do current affairs after lunch or something too, because that also is a time when you laze around. So such times, because current affairs is very interesting, diverse, right?
Yes, ma'am. It can still make you study. Otherwise, if you study static, heavy topic at night, for me,
you can't.
It would be a disaster.
Right. Well, otherwise, generally what people prefer is first thing in the morning, they'll spend 2 hours on newspapers and that's it. They say this is a great achievement and I'm done.
But then, ma'am, to cut you short, but then ma'am, in the morning itself, no website would release their notes. All the notes come by evening or night.
Right.
So, you know, I used to see the compiled notes first and then I used to make from the newspaper. So that is how I could complete it in 40 minutes. Otherwise, if you start in the morning, then you take 2 hours to do the newspaper itself. So that is how I planned
it. That's a very good strategy. Right. Then one more question which we have is, there is one Mr. Sharma Pankaj. I would just like to read his message. It's not a question, but I would. Yes. I think you should get across this message. He says, Aishwarya Di, mera aapse ek hi question hai. मैंने हर मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म पर आपको मैसेज किया था लेकिन आंसर नहीं मिला. कल जब आप कोई लाइव टीवी पे थे तब भी मैंने आपको क्वेश्चन पूछा लेकिन आंसर नहीं मिला. दी यही क्वेश्चन है कि आप गांव कब आ रहे हो? चुपकिया तालुका. पूरा गांव आपका वेट कर रहा है. हम सब बहुत खुश है. आप हमारा इंस्पिरेशन हो. और चाबुकिया टॉकिंग. दिस इज आई थिंक राजघर डिस्ट्रिक्ट चूरू. From Rajasthan, right?
Yes,
this
ma'am.
Is Mr. Pankaj Sharma.
Hometown. From Rajgarh is my hometown. I belong to Churu district of Rajasthan. Thank you so much for reading out the message, ma'am.
Yes, because it's filled with so much emotions.
Yes, ma'am. Abhi main kisi social media platform pe hoon nahin, toh main kaise reply karu? But I really appreciate jo itna pyar, itna samman mujhe sab log de rahe hain. Mere gaon ne hamesha mujhe support kiya hai. Even when I went for Miss India. You know, usually there's an image ki if you're from the Jat community, they don't let their girls come out and they're very apprehensive about all these things. But ma'am, I would like to say that my family, my community, especially in my district, they've been very supportive throughout. And that gave me the confidence to, you know, take risks and venture out in the fields I wanted to.
So your military background gives you the discipline, your preparation for Femina, that gives you the confidence, and the preparation for civil services has made you complete. So like you went through the rigor of UPSC preparation, you have come out as a diamond now. Wish you all the very best.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
it was nice meeting you initially too, and it is wonderful meeting you again too. We have had, I would like to
emphasize,
I would like to emphasize really, we have had many toppers earlier too. Like many toppers, we have had our full course students also toppers who have scored 2-digit ranks, better than your rank too. But then when you approach them after the result, the attitude is different, which we did not see in your case. So like, we really appreciate that. Really, thank you so much for giving much of your time.
Ma'am, I think being a civil servant, you should live up to its name. You are first the servant of the people. And if I don't get give credit to the institutions and those people who have helped me in this journey, then I think I don't deserve this rank altogether. So ma'am, your feedback really helped me to stay original in my interview, and I think I should pay back in whatever way I can.
Thank you so much. Thank you for giving so much of your time. It was wonderful talking to you, and I'm sure all the students have been inspired and they'll follow your rigor and your preparation strategy, and we'll be taking their interviews next year. Thank you so much.
Definitely, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us. Wish you all the very best for the future. Thank you.
Thank you.